is on Soul Food. This is our final day of consecration, and I am wanting to wrap this series up, hopefully in a way that is relevant not only to the time and the moment we're in, but also giving you and I a trajectory for how I hope we can be faithful to God and allow our faithfulness to God in many respects to sustain our lives. I want you to know that while our relationship with God is not transactional, meaning that God blesses you with blessings that you could never repay, right? So it's not like you do a little bit of good and then God gives you back a little bit of good. It's like God just gonna be good to you even when you a hot mess, amen. Now it don't mean that you should just walk around being a hot mess. Because how many know being a hot mess actually, you know, is a problem for you, amen. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Amen. Like, you know, God is going to be God regardless of the messiness of humanity. But I also know and I believe that for whatever reason, God has ordained it to be so. That the work that God would do to take care of the world, to even, dare I say, reconcile the world back to God, will be done in large part through the presence and the faithfulness of we, the church, and those who name the name of Jesus and are following God's ways. And so there is so much at stake when you and I are leaning into seasons of consecration, seasons of spiritual disciplines, because in large part, it is actually helping to make us more faithful to God. Because in our faithfulness to God, St. Augustine talks about this the best, I think. He talks about how we are ultimately blessed by our right worship and faithfulness to God. That blessings come when we are rightly in tune with the one who created us, versus us being at odds with the Creator and all that God has created. So at the center of our lives then must be God and God's ways and God's truths. And the consecration, these acts of spiritual discipline, help put us more in tune with God. Now, let's be clear that because according to our Christian tradition, the world is a fallen world, meaning that the world is not how God intended it to be. That God started off and everything was good, and then human beings, we all started to make all these decisions that rebelled in the face of God. And I know some folks be like, well, I wasn't there to make all them bad decisions. Why? I got to pay for it. So let me just help you. Starting tomorrow, I want you to wake up and make the right decision every time. All right? And then as soon as you make a wrong decision, then you can join the rest of us in the fallen world. All right? Touch your neighbor, somebody. Amen. It ain't just about what they did back then. How many know it's about what we do every day? Right? That often we are often at war with ourselves and with God to live out the way God intends. And so these consecrations give you and I an opportunity to collect the kind of soul we've been talking about, a soul food that empowers and unleashes the soul force, that power within us that is able to transform and sustain us and those around us. Therefore, we're going to continue this series. We're going to do two passages of scripture. One is coming from the prophets, and another is coming from an epistle, a letter from Paul to one of his mentees. Let's start in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 58. This is such a powerful text, and I could just do a Bible study text on this all by itself, but I'm going to try to integrate it into the conclusion of this consecration series because I do think that it helps you and I to understand what the true result and intent of a fast is. It is not, and we have not done this to starve ourselves. I joked about trying to get back to my pre-pregnancy weight, right? that the fast is not intended for that purpose, although it will help. Amen. But how many know you can go on a diet and still have no spiritual transformation, right? That there's something more deep about the kind of fast that is being called. So Isaiah chapter 58, remember Isaiah is writing these letters, or these letters are being written to the community who has come out of exile. So they have been in exile, they've been in bondage, they've been away from the place that has been called home. And now they are coming back to a place where they have some self-determination. They can gather and they can rebuild their life the way that they intended to follow the ways of the Torah, the ways of God. And so because they've been in bondage so long, many of them, they forgot what exactly they were called to do. So the role of the prophet, many of you know, if you heard me preach on the prophets over these last 10 or 11 years, is always to call the children of God back into right responsibility and relationship with God. So the prophet, how many know, never goes out of business, this kind of prophet, right? Because there are some prophets that are like, you know, trying to be fortune tellers, you know, try to tell you your future. Tell you who you're going to marry and how much money's coming your way. Them prophets, unfortunately, don't ever go out of business either, but they make a good business off of many of God's people. So I'm not talking about those kind of exploitative prophets. I'm talking about the prophet that's willing to tell us the truth, even when it's uncomfortable. You ought to thank God for the prophets God puts in your life. Amen. Some of us, we not surrounded by anybody that can tell us the hard truth. We love to believe a beautiful lie, but give your neighbor a high five and tell them, I thank God for the prophets. I thank God for the prophets because these prophets gonna keep you alive. Mm-hmm. Isaiah chapter 58, verse number 6. This is the Message translation, so it may read a little bit paraphrased, but come on with me. It's on the screen if you want to follow. It says, this is the kind of fast that I'm after. And this is God talking. A fast to break the chains of injustice. Get rid of exploitation in the workplace. Free the oppressed. Cancel debts. What I'm interested in seeing you do is, listen, sharing your food with the hungry. Inviting the homeless poor into your homes. Putting clothes on the shivering, ill-clad, being available to your own families. Verse number, I think, 9 we're at. Do this and the lights will turn on. Your lives will turn around at once. Your righteousness will pave your way. The God of glory will secure your passage. Then when you pray, God will answer. You'll call out for help, and God will say, here I am. If you get rid of unfair practices, quit blaming victims, quit gossiping about other people's sins, if you are generous with the hungry and start giving yourselves to the down and out, your lives will begin to glow in the darkness. Your shadowed lives will be bathed in sunlight. I will always show you where to go. I'll give you a full life in the emptiest of places. Firm muscles, strong bones. You'll be like a well-watered garden, a gurgling spring that never runs dry. You'll use the old rubble of past lives to build anew. Rebuild the foundations from out of your past. You'll be known as those who can fix anything. Restore old ruins, rebuild and renovate, make the community livable again. Now that's some good stuff, amen? Isaiah 58, you ought to read that whole chapter on your own. And just ask yourself, now that I've gone through this fast, this consecration, I've engaged in this soul food, how much of this light is coming on in my life? Or am I just now ready to go eat some meat and I'm glad this month is over? That's not what the outcome of this consecration should be. In summation, 2 Timothy verse 1 and 7, then, I hope, serves as another framing for how we will preach and teach today. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-discipline. I'll say it again. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-discipline. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. Bow your heads with me as we finish this series on soul food. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. May we hide this word in our heart so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. All right, soul food, this is our final sermon. Simply, I'll just give a subtopic, work it out. Work it out. Now, I am very much troubled by all of the things that have been happening in the last couple years, for sure, and maybe even beyond that, because I do know how terrible human beings can be to one another. And I have also become acutely aware that claiming to be a follower of Jesus has not been enough to keep Christians, so-called, from causing great harm to other people. If I could even be more explicit, I can say history has shown us that being a Christian in name has not even caused Christians to not kill other Christians. That there is something problematic about how you and I can claim to be in such love with Jesus and yet stand by and watch other folk who are, if we just go through with a narrow lens, other Christians who are so in love with Jesus that we could do things that would put their lives in jeopardy. And it forces me to ask the question, why? What is it about how we are being formed and shaped by our faith and or our context where it seems faithfulness to the peaceful, loving, healing ways of Jesus can quickly be lost and overwhelmed by the violent, warmongering, death-dealing ways of our culture? I'm reminded of a Rwanda genocide course I took when I was at Duke. One of my mentors, his name is Emmanuel Katongole. He was a Catholic priest from Uganda whose family was in Rwanda. And he talked about in this class how 93% of the country of Rwanda claimed to be Christian. And about the remainder were religious minorities, many of whom were Muslim. And it was so fascinating because these cultural groups that were imposed by the colonial powers inside the country of Rwanda turned folks into these arbitrary groups called Hutus and Tutsis. And even though if you go back far enough in Rwanda's country's history, these were the same folk. It was just the colonial powers pretty much named Tutsis Tutsi based off of the sleek features of their face and named Hutus Hutus because they did not look as European. It was very much that arbitrary. And over centuries, these distinctions set in, so much so that when the country's government of Rwanda began to declare that we must take the lives of our Tutsi brothers, sisters, and loved ones, many of the Hutus turned on even their family members. And over 100 days, over 1 million, just in 100 days, 1 million Rwandans were killed. It's one of the worst genocides in history. And it was so terrible that some of the Hutu priests, some don't know if it was because they were filled with this kind of propaganda and hatred, or they were just fearful. Many of the priests would welcome Tutsis into their congregation, making them feel as if they were being offered sanctuary. And when the militias would come with knives and blades and hatchets, they would open up their congregations with the Tutsis hovering inside and kill them right on the altars of the church. There were even some pictures that we were shown where the buildings were burned in fire to the ground. And there was a picture I'll never forget of a mother in a fetal position, pregnant with a child. And she was burned to death. And her body was preserved by, you know, the aftermath of the fire with course, a dead baby and her curled up on the altar of the church. And it just impacted me so much because Dr. Katangale asked us this question. He said, what was it and is it about the way Christians were formed by the church in Rwanda that when the government said to kill their Christian brothers and sisters, the church could not resist? And then he juxtaposed this with the religious minorities who were Hutus and Tutsis, and how when the militia showed up, they all stood in solidarity and said, you will not kill our loved ones unless you're going to kill all of us. And in many, many more cases than not, they survived that genocide because of their solidarity across difference. You see, part of what I think is at stake for us in this moment is that we are being asked to make false choices about who deserves to have life and who deserves to be protected. And who deserves to be valued. These distinctions are often rooted in a human document called the Constitution of the United States that from its beginning has left a lot of folk out, even though some of us over the last 200 or so years have finally made it in by the skin of our chinny chin chin. And some folk have forgotten that if you are not included in a social contract, then it matters very little the kind of distinctions folk will try and lay on top of you. Because if you're not protected, if you're not valued, if you're not human, if you're not seen as created in the image of God, then even that which God has created to be good can eventually succumb to evil. My brothers and sisters, this is a moment, I believe, where the church is now being called into a public battle for our Christian faith and practice. Because it is clear that there are some folk in this country who name to be Christian who are more concerned with their personal radical safety that is often dominated by a manufactured fear that they're willing to throw a whole lot of folk away just to hope that they can survive something that is not even likely to touch them. I mean, I talk all the time, you know, all of us who've been working in the gun violence prevention field, I say, how can we who follow the Prince of Peace be so committed to owning a piece at all costs, right? We supposed to be agents of peace in the world, and yet we stockpiling tools of destruction. And so I say, you know, if it's true that you're trying to be safe, don't you know that you're more likely to be safe if you don't own that weapon of destruction? Because you think you getting it for protection, but all the research says that you're more likely to be shot by that gun or shoot someone in your family with that gun than you are the criminal you hope, I guess, to put a hot one in if they make it inside your house. Manufactured fear. Fear that is often irrational can lead us to doing evil things. And so when you and I claim to follow Jesus, and we are so easily given to fear, don't you know it robs you and I of the number one action that you and I are called to have toward one another, and that is love. Because it's hard to love folk you're afraid of. I wish I could talk to somebody in here. I mean, you know, you can have some feelings of, you know, affirmation and affability, but how many of you know if fear has gripped your heart, usually the source of your fear will be that target, will become a target of erasure or exclusion rather than a target or object of affection. You see, what I believe the church is being called to in this moment, and why you and I have to rely on filling ourselves up continually with this soul food, is because many of us now are going to go back to an old steady diet of things that arguably contribute to our fear, anger, and pain. And now I'm not talking about just some meat. Hello, somebody. Because we were supposed to, somebody say supposed to, we were supposed to stop looking at so much of this carnal foolishness that causes you and I to be filled with such anxiety. And I know it was hard for me because part of my job requires me to listen to some of these talking heads that ain't talking about nothing, read some of these articles that is nothing but propaganda, or as the sister said on the screen the other day, alternative facts. Hello, somebody. And when your life, when your diet becomes alternative facts and propaganda, you will not be able to do what Jesus said when he said, buy the truth and sell it not. Hold on to that which is true. Why? Because that which is true will be life-giving to you. It will provide you with the source of life that you can then provide to others. But when our lives are overwhelmed by junk food, by unhealthy diets of culture and politics and art and stimuli that have no power to sustain your life, no wonder you and I are filled with depression and anxiety and so overwhelmed, because we are not feeding our soul that which will keep our soul force at full power. And if there's ever a time God's people need to be at full power, it is now. So when you and I take seriously that there is a fight and a battle for the public witness of Christian faith and practice, it causes you and I to ask all kinds of questions about who then will our legacy of discipleship be most influenced by. Understand, we are not the first generation of the church to have to push back against forces of injustice and evil and sin and death. How many of you know the overwhelming history of the church, particularly the black church in the United States, has been about resisting structural oppression and racism? Hello, somebody. That is our legacy. Now, admittedly, some of us didn't have a choice. Because you waking up and you know that your life could very well be over for the color of your skin, being in the wrong neighborhood, looking in the eyes of someone. We just heard that the woman who supposedly accused Emmett Till of whistling at her, she's 80-something years old. She now came out and said what? She lied. Now, Emmett Till, listen to this. Emmett Till's mom was a mother in the Church of God in Christ. If you know anything about the Church of God in Christ, it is one of the Pentecostal holiness denominations where many of us get some of our roots and direction from. And then it's something that even though they were part of the sanctified church, that evil and racism could not protect a young person from the lies of the systemic and structural evil of the day. What am I saying? I'm saying that you and I will not be protected just because we call ourselves Christian. We won't be protected from being unchristian-like, nor will we be protected from having the evil of the world visited upon us. Another hero I'll lift up for me is Archbishop Oscar Romero. He's a Catholic bishop in El Salvador, and he was one of these amazing bishops who was, during the years of Jimmy Carter, begging the United States government, please don't send any more weapons into our country because it's going to cause a lot of death for a lot of our people. Jimmy Carter ignored him, sent all these weapons. They said over, I think, 70,000 people ended up dying because of all these weapons. And I want to read to you what Oscar Romero called out to the soldiers. And he said to the soldiers, do not obey your superiors when they order you to kill. You are killing your brothers and sisters in the name of God, in the name of these suffering people whose laments rise to heaven each day more tumultuous. I beg of you, I ask of you, I order you in the name of God, stop the repression. The next week he was executed while preaching in his church. How many of you know it? This is the legacy of Christians who resist evil in the world. Now, you don't hear these stories a lot because the way we talk about American Christianity, we're only talking about either the slaveholder or prosperity gospel. Hello, somebody. But I want you to know, don't let anyone erase prophetic Christian faith that is a part of how our Christian faith can shape us to respond in these moments. That is just a part of our legacy as well. And many of us, dare I say all of us, are being called to live and lean into that faithful response if we're going to be the light that shines in the middle of some of these dark places. If we're going to work out this soul food that God has allowed us to experience through the consecration, I want to argue that there are a few things that you and I first need to do. And I'll use the passage 2 Timothy verse 1 through 7 to serve as our marching orders. He says that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. If you're going to work it out, the first thing you and I need to do is to be grounded in love. Everybody say love. Now, understand that in 1 John 4:18, it simply says this, that perfect love casts out all fear. So if you and I take this verse seriously, you and I must appreciate that if God has not given us the spirit of fear or cowardice, but first of love, then you have to cultivate love in your life. Not the kind of love that is about the shiver that runs up and down your spine. Not the kind of love that's just about what makes you feel good, but love that is commitment to the highest order of things that finds its truth and its center in God. This love will become the source. It will be the grounding. It will be the fuel, if you will, that keeps you moving forward against all the odds and forces of hatred and violence that come your way. Now, I know that love in our society is often something that is extremely sentimentalized. But I love James Lawson, who was one of the mentors of Dr. King. He was part of the SNCC, I believe, in. He talked about how love is not a feeling. Love is a force. Like the wind, like the rain, like a hurricane. Love is a force that if you unleash it, it will transform everything it touches. And could it be that what the world needs more of is this kind of love? A love that is able to turn even the coldest heart, the hardest heart, into a heart of flesh. I know in these moments it's hard to love, particularly when you see so much hatred. But this is why the practices of what we've been doing in the consecration are so critical, because you practice love. You don't feel the love. Love is an action word. That means you and I have to put into practice things that cultivate our love. When you're out there protesting on behalf of the oppressed, guess what you're doing? You're cultivating love. Now, you could be out there cultivating anger too. But that's why you have to be cognizant of the posture and the source by which you are acting out from. When I show up in the streets, when I show up in the courts, when I show up in the White House, when I show up on my job, when I show up at my house, you must show up and ask God, give me the love. The love that covers a multitude, a diversity, a manifold presence of sins, of wrongs. How many know that love don't come from you? That love don't come from me. That love has to come from God, from a source that is greater than us. These disciplines then help you and I to have a love that will cause our soul force, that part of us that we've been strengthening, to be sustained continually. So one of the questions that are worthy of our reflection, how deep is our love? Where is your love originating from? Is it originating out of who you like, what makes you feel good, or is it coming from a deep well of spirit and soul that is connected and emanating from God? What kind of soul food must you continue to feed yourself to hear and respond to the cries of the margin? Because be clear, it is the margins that will test the extent and the depth of our love. Whoever is on your margin, whoever you don't think belongs in your circle, that will be the measure stick of your love. It won't just be who you like, who you agree with. Hello, somebody. I've had to learn to love some folk. And God put them in my life, I believe. Oh, thank you, God. Because God knew that if I did not cultivate a love for them, then my love for God may wax cold in the time of great trial and tribulation. I don't know about you, but I don't want my love to run out when the love is needed as the source of my resistance, of my construction, of my assignment. Hello, somebody. My wife got this electric car. And we only can go so many miles before the thing runs out. And it's quite a journey and an adventure when you're looking at your mileage ticking down. And you don't know really how far away you are from your destination. And you're sitting there driving, and you're trying to find out, if I drive faster, will it cause my energy to go out faster? If I drive slower, will it take me longer to get there and then I'll run out? How many know there ain't nothing like driving on an empty tank? Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. Well, that's what happens when you let your love grow weak. You're trying to do the work of God in the world on an empty tank. And you know how some of us get when we start to get tired. Don't you say, you got one more time. Look at your neighbor and say, empty tank. Don't you look at me that way. If you look at me that way, I'm telling you, not today, right? Show up in the work. Like they said, I'll show up in the work talking about what you're not going to do today. I'm not going to do this. And I empty tank. But you can't do the will of God who is love if you aren't cultivating the love. What are those practices? We just went through those practices. They're spiritual practices because love is a spirit. It comes from God. You're not going to get more love by reading some books. You're going to get some love by engaging in the practices of the soul and the spirit and invite God, Lord, fill me up with this love. Pat yourself on the chest, say, I need more love, I need more love, I need more love. The second thing the text says, and I'm going to move a little quick here, is that you and I must have power. Somebody say power. The soul food that we are consuming empowers us to be the witnesses of God in the world. Here in the text, it says that you and I will have what we need to build old ruins, rebuild, renovate, restore, make the community livable again. The power we need is not power so we can have authority to lord over one another, to rule over one another. But God gives you and I power as people of God so we can build the kingdom of God. So we can use our power, our privilege, our opportunities to build up what the enemy is trying to tear down. And I want to submit to you that part of why we must be filled with God's power is so we have the strength to complete the assignment that has been put before us. And it is the power to do particular things. It's the power to restore those old places, to rebuild those broken down places, to renovate, do something new in the places that are beyond restoration and beyond rebuilding. How many know there's some places in your life, in our lives, that need restoration? Places in our lives that need some rebuilding. Some of it is so far gone, it's like you can't restore and rebuild. You got to do something new. God gives you this power through the soul food, through these practices of fasting, of prayer, of studying, of service, so we can unleash that power to rebuild and restore and renovate that which is falling apart around us. And I want you and I to be cognizant that while some gain power to oppress, our power will always be used towards liberation. Or you will have your power taken from you. Hello, somebody. God, help the church. Help us to be people who can be good stewards of this power. When Jesus left and he kept his disciples here, he told them, go up into the upper room and you will receive power after the Holy Spirit comes upon you to be witnesses. Isn't it something that how you build, how you restore, how you renovate is the greatest witness you'll ever be in the world? Some of us feel like, well, you know, I gotta help you say the sinner's prayer. I gotta give you a track. I gotta make you roll on the floor, swing from the chandeliers, do a couple things. And I'm not hating on any of that. Some of us need to roll on the floor and swing from the chandeliers. Amen. Get over ourselves. Touch your neighbor. Let the Holy Ghost just give you one of them renovations. But until that happens, give your neighbor a high five and tell him, until it happens, amen, I'm going to work for your liberation. I'm going to work for God to turn you inside out, to help make you free so you can experience the fullness of God's love and creation in the world. Question then, and this is an important question, because all of us with our power, with our privilege, with whatever we got, how many know we are either building and creating things that uphold systems and ideas which steal the life and hope of our loved ones, or we're using that power to tear it down? What are you using your power for? In this season, in this moment where we see certain folks being targeted, when we ourselves are getting targeted, how many of you know that the power that has been given to us can be used as a source of liberation? I'm blessed by all the lawyers who stayed up all night using their power to help liberate some folk. Some say, well, what was they doing before? It don't matter. I don't know what they was doing before. I know what they did last night. Hello, somebody. Some of us, we get real self-righteous because we act like we was out there in the streets. And you wasn't, because I didn't see you, praise God. How do you know that whenever you come into your power, the consciousness of your power that God's given us to liberate, I welcome you into the liberation party. I don't be like, well, you didn't show up last week. You didn't show up the week before. So you stay at home. Go somewhere else. This ain't for you. No, 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 no. This is what Jesus told his disciples, because his disciples was kind of hating like that, right? Well, Jesus, you know, you sent us out, and I see other people out there doing what you told us to do. What's up with that? Jesus said, if they are doing what I've called you to do, they're not your enemy. They're on your side. So you welcome their participation in building up God's kingdom and tearing down the forces of evil. What are you using your power to build? And then the last thing, and we'll spend some time responding in prayer. Self-discipline. Yes. Soul food. End of the consecration. Self-discipline. Form your lips, as hard as it may be, to say self-discipline. I knew it would be hard because only half y'all said it. Amen. Look at your neighbor, tell them self-discipline. God has given you the spirit of self-discipline. Meaning that don't you dare just go back to these old habits. These habits that will get you back into the place where you needed the consecration in the first place. Wish I could talk to you. Hello, somebody. Self-discipline means that you are able to sustain that which you started. Repetition for these last 21 to 30 days has trained your body and your soul that if you have the discipline to keep going, maybe not at the same intensity, but at some level of consistency, you will find yourself getting stronger, being able to do and accomplish and sustain the work that God has done in and through us. The greatest companion of self-discipline is repetition. You got to wake up every day. We had our prayer lines 3 days a week. Why? Because we know that some of us don't pray that often. In the morning and in the evening. Besides you blessing your food. And we know many of our food blessings. Lord, thank you. Amen. How many of that? That's not a prayer life. That's not enough to sustain you. That's not repetition. I don't know what that is. That's like you getting dressed to go work out and you go eat at the restaurant. You started an effort, but it achieved no bodily impact. Hello, somebody. Self-discipline means that you're going to keep praying. You're going to carve out time in your day to seek God's face. Before you look at your Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, all that stuff, you're going to say, God, what would you say to me today? Before you run to the club, you're going to make sure you're volunteering and serving somebody. Hello, somebody. Before you gossip about other people's problems, talking about some repetition, you're going to practice minding your own business. Woo. Somebody talk about, say, consecration. Before you jump headlong into the agenda of this empire called the United States of America, you're going to check and make sure that the kingdom of God and God's agenda that has no pleasure in the death of anyone will always trump the agenda of this empire that seems to be addicted to the death of anyone who stands in the way. My loved ones, this is who and what we must be. Coming off the heels of the consecration, we can't just be the same. In this moment, in this time, God is requiring the church to not forget who we are. And that kind of self-discipline will often be the result of us continuing to go through the practices that toughen up our skin, that train our mind, that prepare our hands and our feet to do the work that God's called us to do. How many of you know you got to go through some things in order to get toughened up sometimes? I know some of us want to just be born the kind of tough person. But how many know you got to go through a few fights sometimes to get toughened up? I remember watching this movie called The Knockaround Guys with Vin Diesel. And Vin Diesel, you know, a big old kind of hunk of a man. Amen. You know, he looked like he's impenetrable, right? In all these movies, he looked like he's Incredible Hulk just walking around in a regular person's body. But in the movie Knockaround Guys, he was in a bar getting ready to, you know, deal with something. And this guy walks up to him and he's getting ready to fight him. Before the one punch gets thrown, Vin Diesel says 500. The guy says, what are you talking about? I'm getting ready to up. He says 500 fights is what it took in my neighborhood to become a bona fide tough guy. Then he took off his coat. You know, he started doing all this flexing, you know, just bada bing, bada boom, bada ba 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 ba. And he said, at first, the fights used to bring fear. And they used to make me nervous. And I would retreat, but I knew I couldn't go too far, so I would just stay in the fight. He said, but after a certain while, you start to look forward to it. Because you want to test what you learned in your last fight. And he said, you get used to the punches, and you can even often start to anticipate where the blows are coming from. And you can begin to move out of harm's way. And even if you get hit, your body and your skin toughens to a point where you can endure even the blows that are coming at you. And I want to submit to you, child of God, today that some of us are getting closer to our 500. That we have gone through this spiritual boot camp and our whole life has been really predicated on all these struggles and difficulties. But how many of you know that the more you keep going through it, and the more that God keeps building things up inside of you, you will not fail at the point of your conflict. At the point of the struggle, you will continue to push through. So what does that mean? That means that you got to remember all the way through it who you are. You are a chosen generation. You are God's chosen people. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation, God's special people. And God has prepared you for this moment. God has prepared us for this moment. Just like the Dietrich Bonhoeffers resisted the Third Reich in Germany. Sojourner Truth, Frederick Douglass, John Brown resisted the terror of slavery. Cesar Chavez resisted the oppression of the farm worker movement. Yo Mama and them resisted the difficulty of just daily living. You have what it takes through the power of God's Spirit to resist and be sustained in the season of Trump, in the season of cancer, in the season of divorce, in the season of addiction, in the season of depression. You have what it takes. Because God will not leave you without what you need. Just keep eating the soul food. Keep feeding yourself that which brings you life. Resist that devil. Scripture says if you resist the devil will flee. Because I think the moment you put space between you and the devil, God fills that space. And how many know God can't be defeated by no devils? Come on, stand with me. We need to stop. We need to end.